welcome, rock and roll rebels, to another episode of Ramble On with Rosie. That would be me, your host Rosie, and I am here to discuss the ins, outs, and opinions I have on good old rock and roll. We'll be discussing an interesting album today. It's not exclusively a rock album. It's honestly uncategorizable because it's so different, unique. It was the first album of its kind, and other than the other six albums that followed it by this band, I don't know that there's any other music quite like it. That would be the first album of the Moody Blues to have Justin Hayward. Days of Future Past, done with the London Festival Orchestra. I'm not just going to be discussing the album, though that will feature heavily. I will be discussing a desire I have had to see done with the music in the album. I'm also kind of thumbing my nose at a convention because I had a friend who's done radio tell me that, you know, if you want to impress people with radio, you know, if you to get like a job, don't discuss albums. It's not popular. Well, my dad grew up with FM radio. And they discussed albums. So I will take my outdated, album-loving heart all the way down the road and do what I want, because that is what rock and roll is about, after all. Speaking of FM radio, the advent of FM radio in America was very timely at the release of this album, because this album came out in 1967, and it is almost the very first concept album. Sgt. Pepper's came out in May of 67, and this album came out in November. So they're really close, and while Sgt. Pepper's is popularly described as the first concept album, I personally don't entirely agree with that, because while some people are like, oh, a concept album is, you know, it has, like, the beginning and the end, and, you know, sort of like an overture sort of symphonic feel to it, and in the fact that, you know, it ties together. But to me, my standard for a concept album is, can I listen to a track off of it and feel like I'm missing something? As in, like, if you listen to Time off of Dark Side of the Moon, if you listen to Time, or one of the other songs off of Dark Side of the Moon, do you feel like it's a good song, but I know I'm only getting part of the full piece? Kind of like listening to Beethoven's Ode to Joy. You know that it's an epic piece of music, and the chorale part is famous, but you also know you're not getting the whole thing. It's like listening to an aria for an opera. You know you're not getting the whole opera, you're just getting the little highlight portion. And to me, that's what songs off of true concept albums do, is you're like, I know I'm not getting the full experience listening to this song. I want to go listen to the whole album. I feel that way every time they play the Moody Blues on the radio. I'm like, where's the next track? Because they all bleed into each other. Which is another thing I feel like true concept albums kind of do. So, I don't view Sgt. Pepper's as a concept album. I had no idea it was considered one until somebody told me it was. And, like, I have the album, so it's not like I didn't listen to it when I was young. It was part of that big lot of records that my uncle plopped in my lap and said, sort through, and if it's in good condition, you can keep it. Thank you, Uncle Rick. But anyways, to continue with Days of Future Past, it was actually conceived as a way for Decca Records to show off its advancements in stereo. Their Duramic sound, because Durham was a, like, sub-label of Decca Records, had, you know, they had the stereophonic sound that they really wanted to show off, which had been really popular with the classical music crowd. So the Moody Blues, kind of being in debt to the record company a little bit, they were like, hey, y'all do us a solid and go record with the symphony a orchestral rock version of Dvorak's The New World Symphony. They totally didn't do that. They were like, you know what? let's scrap that idea and we'll write our own music. And then the conductor guy by the name of Knight, we'll look up his first name. I want to say it's Peter. Anyways, conductor Peter Knight, I believe. He's Peter. Yes, Peter Knight. You know, would fill in with the orchestral parts. So that was the plan. And the plan went off better than anybody could have possibly envisioned. Because, like, this wasn't what the record company asked for. In fact, the band didn't even share any of their progress with the record label people until it was all done. Basically, there was a conspiracy amongst, you know, Peter Knight, the band members of the Moody Blues, and I imagine the members of the orchestra, too, to just not tell the record company anything till it was all done. And they were a little iffy at first. You know, they're like, maybe, but we're not quite sure how to market this. Which, honestly, you can understand. Like I said, Days of Future Past is kind of uncategorizable album. Like, it's not classical. It's not rock and roll. It's not blues. It's not pop. It's not folk. It's everything in no specific genre at the same time. So, you can understand the challenge that they were up against. Although, how they were going to market a classical rock album based off of Dvorak's New World Symphony is equally puzzling. Regardless, the representative for Decca in America was like, well, if they don't want it, I want it, because this is going to be great in the U.S. because FM radio plays whole albums! And they don't care if a single's 4 minutes long or not. Because Nice and White Satin was about 4.5 minutes long. In fact, I think it was, John Lodge was like, we basically pioneered the fact that singles didn't have to be under 3.5 minutes. That you could have a 4.5 minute single, because Nice and White Satin is about 4.5 minutes long. So, they were pioneering everything from the concept album to the over 3.5 minute long singles. They were busting down all the doors and barriers, and the fact that the Moody Blues don't get given their proper credence as a revolutionary rock band is a blight on the world. I'm like, I'm sorry, but they should be in conversations the same way that Led Zeppelin and the Beatles and Van Halen are. Like, they shook up the game. I mean, Days of Future Past came out 2 years before The Who's Tommy. Like, they were perfecting the concept album when the concept album had literally just become a concept. I mean, like I said, Sgt. Pepper's was only about 6 months before, so they were really close. And Days of Future Past definitely feels like more of a concept album than Sgt. Pepper's does. So, that being the case, they, took it, and it eventually, like, Nights in White Satin, I think, made it to the top five on Billboard by the early 70s, and this came out in 67. So it took a while, but they did eventually, you know, just slowly and steadily climb. They went out of just being, like, an avant-garde niche, you know, highbrow thing into being popularly accepted. Thank you, probably a great deal to FM radio playing whole albums. So, that's my take on why it's still cool to talk about a whole album on a show. Because FM radio used to play whole albums. And why they don't still, I don't understand. I say we have like a resurgent renaissance movement and get FM radio to like play whole albums late at night like they used to when my dad would go listen to them. I can't remember which albums he said he'd, you know, listened to quite often late at night on FM radio when they played the whole thing. But he listened to a few that way, so I say bring it back! Late night FM with full albums! If I become a radio DJ, I'm gonna make that happen. Anyway, so that's the backstory for Days of Future Past before I launch into my actual topic. Which is, to me, and I have said this my whole life, the Moody Blues are the love child of classical music and rock and roll. There was a heat of night of passion and nights in white satin between classical music and prog rock, and out came the Moody Blues. And they came out rocking and also just vibing with peaceful classical vibes. Which is why, for the real topic here, Days of Future Past needs to be made into a ballet. And I have felt strongly about this since I was like 12. My whole life. I mean, I grew up listening to a lot of classical music. The first 12 years of my life, classical was my jam. And ballet especially. I love the music that goes to ballet. Even when I, you know, didn't even really know about the dance side of ballet that much, I knew the music. And I love Tchaikovsky, who really was sort of a pioneer of, you know, that generation of ballet, of, you know, especially with working with the ballet choreographer to get all the lyrics, to get all the notes and everything right for the dances that the choreographer wanted to do, but also make music that would be enjoyable, where people might come to a ballet to hear the music more than to see the people dance and, you know, get the best of both worlds. Or, well, they didn't have records yet, but one day they would buy records of ballets. Instantly, it's way too hard to find full ballets on records. They're like, let's have a ballet suite. And I'm like, that's like listening to Time instead of the whole Dark Side of the Moon album. I want the whole thing. So, yet again, another correlation between concept albums and classical music. And that being really the main crux here of this conversation is how Days of Future Past truly needs to be turned into a ballet. All the elements are there. I'm one of those people, I like my ballets to have stories. And the passage of a day, as laid out in Days of Future Past, also working as a mirror concept to the lives of man, would make a great theme for a ballet. Like, you can listen to The Day Begins and The Morning and sort of see little children tiptoeing through a park, and, you know, it has a very youthful, like, child youthful. And the lyrics, too. I mean, the lyrics to The Morning. I think it's The Morning, right? Yeah. Dawn. Dawn is a feeling. And what's the other one? Yeah. Another Morning is what I'm thinking of, not Dawn is a Feeling. Another Morning very much is about childhood. There's the, you know, fairy queen and $1,000 is a dream and cotton frocks and golden locks and her palace is an orange box. This girl who used to play in refrigerator boxes, whenever my family got into a refrigerator, I highly identify with that line. I kind of always wanted to get an empty orange box from the grocery store and play in it because it seemed like fun. So, you know, the big orange boxes that are like a pit, you know, watermelons also come in them too. I wanted to do that. I never got that opportunity, but I played many a refrigerator box. So, like, it's about childhood, both lyrically and, you know, the melody feels childlike. You know, you can picture kids running around in a park. And then it progresses and you get to lunch and peak hour, and that little part with the symphony between Another Morning and peak hour, you can sort of see that in between childhood and adulthood teenage phase. Like, the music feels a little bit more mature but still playful. You can kind of imagine, you know, teenage boys chasing girls around, but at that stage where they're not sure if they want to ask them on a date or, you know, pull their pigtails. That stage of, you know, usually around 13, 14, 15, where, like, I feel differently about the opposite sex, but tradition says they still have cooties. So, like, you get that feeling there, and lunch break, peak hour, totally has the hectic mayhem of adult world. You know, it feels like you're running around with 100 things to do in that song. Excuse me. And the Tuesday afternoon segment feels a little bit slower, like you're, you know, having, you know, settling down, you're finding your true love. You could totally put in a, I may butcher the French pronunciation, and that's embarrassing because I have a French last name, but I believe it's pronounced a pas de deux, the dance for two, there with Tuesday Afternoon, I'm picturing all this set in like a park. So you can have children running around and then couples dancing, and you know, there's sort of like a city square nearby for people to be running around on their lunch break through the park. And then, you know, the evening, things have slowed down even more, got a little bit more somber, and it's like settling into life with, and you know, aging with whoever the, you know, person they married was, you know, the person they found. And the Knights in White Satin, while it was not written with this purpose, it was simply Hayward writing a song that was inspired by the fact that his girlfriend had given him a set of satin sheets. Kind of mundane, but it works. But the lyrics and the philosophical contemplating, I guess, of the lyrics, you know, the narrator and the lyrics, very much, like, at first listen and without thinking about it in the context of the stages of man, it sounds like a love song. But it is not exclusively romantic, and could totally be the perspective of an aging, like, grandfather passing on his sage wisdom to his heirs before he passes. In fact, there's even a portion, I think it's right after the poetry at the end of Knights in White Satin, that there's like this dramatic, I want to say it's violins or something, but it sounds like somebody could be collapsing to the stage. So I really am truly convinced that this would make an amazing ballet. And I have been convinced of this for over half of my life. So I don't know who I need to get a hold of, if I just need to stand in Justin Hayward's yard and cry until they arrest me. I'm willing to try. Please don't arrest me. I just really like music. But it should really be done. It's got all the potential there. And it's a great, great, great album. If you have not looked into the Moody Blues, please do so. Not just this album, but the rest of their albums, especially from Days of Future Past to Seventh Sojourn, when they were at their best. They had Mike Pinder on Mellotron and were amazing. Seeing as I've taken this off, I'm just gonna go ahead and show you. It is my Led Zeppelin 3 hairbreadth. I also have hairbreadths with just Jimmy Page on them, and clip-on Jimmy Page guitar pick earrings too. So that side note there. Speaking of Led Zeppelin 3 and general album art, which is another aspect of this album that really needs to be discussed, and another reason why albums should be discussed on FM radio again, because then it would give DJs a chance to share all the really interesting information that's overlooked, like who maybe the engineer was on the record or produced it, and who did the phenomenal album art when there is phenomenal album art. Like, it was way too hard to find the artist who did such an amazing, interesting, intricate piece of art. I mean, there's the numbers, it's clocks, it's got allusions to time, you know, the parallel faces of the man and woman there, you know, phases of the moon. Like, there's so much going on in this art, and it's so vivid. There's an hourglass, like, it's like a Where's Waldo of themes from the music. And it took way too much effort to find that, you know, I mean, other artists with less exemplary album art, it's easier to find who did their album art. Like, I know Hypnosis did a bunch of, at least two or three of Led Zeppelin's albums. And, I mean, Houses of the Holy has a cool cover, but it's not that cool. It's not as cool as the Days of Future Past cover. And it took me forever to find out who did that. The guy's name was David Anstey, and he has done, he did about a half dozen or so Savoy Brown album covers, and the album cover for the only studio album that Black Cat Bones ever did, Barbed Wire Sandwich, which, that album cover is not for the faint of heart. It looks like some cursed demonic Muppet creature is eating a barbed wire sandwich. Like, view at your own risk. It's not near as cool or pretty as that Days of Future Past album cover. But it is what it is, and I mentioned Black Cat Bones because half of that band would go on to become Free, the Paul Kossoff and Simon Kirk. Half of Black Cat Bones would become Free when Paul Rodgers and Andy Fraser joined. And it's me, so I will always mention anything that has anything to do with Stevie Van Zandt, Bruce Springsteen, Paul Rodgers, or Jimmy Page. Which, other than Paul Rodgers, I have a poster in this room with all of those individuals on it at some point. Led Zeppelin's over there, Bruce is over there, Stevie's behind me. Anyways, so album art. Another reason why FM album playings need to become a thing again, so that these people can be given the credit they deserve, because some of the album art out there, I mean, think about the iconic album covers that were artistic, not just photographic. So, like, Cream's Disraeli, no, not Disraeli Years. Yes, Disraeli Years, not Wheels of Fire. Though Wheels of Fire has a really cool cover, too. I just really love the Disraeli's Years cover. All of the Moody Blues from Days of Future Past to Seventh Sojourn have artistic covers. There's others I can't think of right now. But, you know, where it's art, and it's really cool, and it needs to be given more credit, and I don't understand why it doesn't. So, let's hear it for album covers and their unsung heroes who made them come to life. And that is pretty much all I've got for the day, other than on the note of Days of Future Past becoming a ballet. One of the really key and interesting elements I think that would work out great is the fact that the music very much interweaves the aspects of classical and rock and roll, which would work out great for interweaving classical ballet and more modern ballet styles. And so you could have, like, especially around Peak Hour, you could have, like, the main character be a little bit older, you know, because he's now an adult. And so he's, like, maybe mid-late 20s, but, like, the younger generation behind him, you know, in their floral hippie-looking outfits, dance into the more rock and roll sounds as part of, like, the accompanying, you know, dancers. And so you would get the sense of a passage of time, not just in the main character's life, but also in the upcoming generation behind him. And I think that, and they could be using the more modern ballet style. So you'd get to show off two different styles of ballet with two different, you know, interweave two different styles of ballet with two different styles of music between the classical and the, you know, modern. I say modern, it's 50, over 50 years old now. But you know what I mean. Like, those styles of music paralleling, you know, the styles of ballet that could be demonstrated if it was turned into a ballet. So that is another reason this needs to be a ballet. I'm like, you have the story. You have music that, in my opinion at least, and I'm no expert by any stretch, but I have listened to quite a few ballets. Like, I can name a top five, and I've listened to more than that. My favorite's being Tchaikovsky, Delibes, and Adolf Adam. But anyways, those are my favorite composers of ballet music. Having listened to all that ballet music as a child and young adult, I feel like I can say with a teeny bit of experience, authority, or whatever you want to say it, that the music in Days of Future Past would make a good ballet. And if they had to extend the music, because it's only about 40 or so minutes long, maybe consult the band, get them to, you know, write some supplemental pieces, or consult that composer, Peter Knight, because he's still alive too, I believe. And everybody in the Moody Blues, other than Ray Thomas, is still alive. And consult them and get them to lengthen it. I feel like it could be done. And should be done. And it would make an amazing ballet. And I don't know. If you know anybody that has anything to do with the Moody Blues, or composer, conductor, Peter Knight, please, please just, like, send this to them? This is the my version of Jack Black pleading to use Immigrant Song in School of Rock. I'm pleading that the Moody Blues make a ballet out of their first concept album. I need it, please. Go find some choreographers, make it happen. I've got the concepts! Just somebody take them and make them into a real thing, because I need this. The world needs this, and I would really, truly love to see this happen while the band is still alive, so that they can be consulted on how to and what they do and do not approve of being done with their music. So, on that note, this has just been a whole pitch video to make a ballet out of Days of Future Past, disguised as a rock ramble. I will end this. I hope I have given you some insight, or at least a few chuckles, and that you enjoyed it, and hopefully you check out the Moody Blues if you have not yet. Highly, highly, highly recommend their albums, those seven from Days of Future Past, Seventh Sojourn, are iconic pillars of music and staples of my childhood, and not talked about or given enough credit for their influence. They are their own genre, and that's pretty impressive. So, go listen to the movies, go have a great week, be kind to each other, and rock on! Mary Green today is a queen, $1,000 are a dreaming cock, frocks, and golden locks, her palace is an orange box.